In the first lab exercise, we learned a little about how scientists determine the identity of an unknown molecule, and we're going to expand on that theme in this second virtual lab. There are a variety of molecular diagnostic tools available, and each provides a different clue about the identity of a sample. Often, it is only by examining several of these clues that a scientist can actually make a determination. This exercise includes several learning objectives. First, you will learn how to utilize the webbook site at the National Institute of Standards and Technology, or NIST, to find useful data about molecules. Second, you will develop some understanding of the principles behind infrared, or IR, spectroscopy, and learn to interpret that data for some basic information about bonding. Third, you will learn how to analyze the fragmentation patterns in mass spectra as a means for differentiating between molecules. And fourth, you will use the temperature at which phase changes occur as a confirming piece of evidence for an assignment. One of the most widely used diagnostic tools for studying molecules is spectroscopy. Each molecule absorbs a characteristic set of wavelengths of light, unique to that molecule. This is why, for example, compounds can display different colors. In essence, they absorb different components of visible light. Because the pattern of wavelengths is unique to a given molecule, we can think of this as being like a molecular fingerprint. The different parts of the electromagnetic spectrum tell us about various aspects of the molecular environment. In effect, each region of the spectrum gives us a different clue about the molecule. We can categorize these regions as follows. Ultraviolet and visible light tell us about the environments of the valence electrons. Infrared light tells us about the vibrational motions of the atoms in a molecule. Microwave radiation reveals something about the mass distribution in a molecule through its rotational motion. A spectrum can be measured by passing tunable light of various wavelengths through a sample and detecting which wavelengths of light are absorbed by the molecules in the sample. This will have reduced transmittance of light at particular wavelengths. As an example, here is what an infrared spectrometer looks like in the lab. Since we do not have a virtual spectrometer handy, we will need to find molecular spectra that have already been measured to use in our analyses. A great place to find this information is the NIST webbook site. When you go to the link shown under the title, the top of the page that you enter will look like this. To search for a particular molecule, we will utilize searches either by name or by formula. For example, if we wanted to learn more about the molecule acetone, we could search under its name or under its formula. The latter would produce search results that would include all the isomers having the same formula. Either choice would ultimately lead to the summary page for acetone. Once here, we will access the information needed for this assignment by choosing one of these possibilities: phase change data, IR spectrum, or mass spectrum. Continuing with acetone as an example, if we open its infrared spectrum, we would be shown a graph that looks like this. Please note that this will sometimes require a couple of clicks to choose from several different measured spectra. For each of the samples you analyze, you should try to view an IR spectrum that has relatively sharp features, like this one. There are a couple of important things to note about this graph. Infrared spectra are usually presented in an inverted format. The baseline is located at the top of the graph, and absorptions are displayed as growing downward from this baseline. The units along the horizontal axis are given in wave numbers, or inverse centimeters, a measure that is related to both the wavelength of infrared light that is absorbed and the frequencies of different vibrations in the molecule. The energy of the radiation absorbed increases as one moves from right to left in this graph. In the spectrum shown here, the important features to note are the absorption around 3,000 wave numbers, which is due to the carbon-hydrogen stretching motions, and the large absorption peak at 1,700 wave numbers, which arises from the oxygen-carbon double bond stretch. These frequencies are characteristic of those vibrations, and their signatures can be observed in all molecules that contain these types of chemical bonds. You're already familiar with mass spectra from the first lab exercise, so you will recall that the highest mass peak in a spectrum reflects the molecular weight of the sample. In the case of acetone, it has a mass of 58 and arises from the molecular ion C3H6O+. As we noted in the first lab exercise, the ionization process often produces multiple fragments, which contribute to a pattern of peaks with various masses. Although it is not always possible to predict the likely fragments that will arise from this process, it is not uncommon for the weakest bond in the molecule to be broken, leading to two fragments, either of which could end up as a positive ion. This is the case for acetone, in which the weakest bonds are the two carbon-carbon bonds. When one of these bonds is ruptured, it creates two fragments, one CH3 with mass 15, and the other C2H3O with mass 43. This is shown in acetone's mass spectrum here. You will have an opportunity to use the table of average bond energies given in Module 3 to evaluate which bond in your samples is the weakest and predict the fragments that would be created when that bond is broken. Phase changes occur when a sample changes its physical state. For example, melting from solid to liquid, or boiling from liquid to gas. The temperature at which this change occurs is a characteristic of the substance and is related to the strength of the intermolecular interactions between its molecules. The stronger those attractive forces, the higher the temperature of the phase change. Phase change data are provided in the NIST webbook and are normally labeled T sub fuse for the melting or fusion point and T sub boil for the boiling point or vaporization temperature. The main thing to know about this diagnostic is that it cannot uniquely identify a substance. More than one substance could have the same boiling point or the same melting point. However, these data can be used to eliminate possibilities. For example, if one of your candidates for assignment is recorded as having a melting point at 330 Kelvin, and you're told that your sample is actually a liquid at room temperature, which is 298 Kelvin, then you could safely eliminate that candidate from consideration. In the case of acetone, its melting point is 179 Kelvin, and its boiling point is 329 Kelvin, so at room temperature, it would be a liquid. As before, your analysis procedure is spelled out in the lab background and instructions document. It includes analyzing three pairs of isomers using information gathered from the NIST webbook site, examining various experimental measurements and determining which diagnostics help to distinguish between the two isomers. You will then use a set of input data to unambiguously identify an unknown that has two or more isomers. Your analysis should be recorded by completing the information requested on the Lab 2 report worksheet and answering the post-analysis questions. When you've finished this and submitted the report, each team member should complete the lab review quiz within 24 hours. Good luck, and please let me know if you have questions or encounter any difficulties.